Yes, good morning and welcome. You're watching Pub Breakfast right here on Citizen TV. My name is Freddie Namuli. Third time when we take a look at the headlines this morning. Very interesting headlines, of course, mostly to do with the presidential election petition, where most of the submissions ended yesterday. The judges have retreated to make their ruling, which will be presented on Friday. Now, on the front page of the Daily Nation, Uhuru defends win amid fight over poll audit. Remember yesterday, one of the biggest submissions were by the third respondent, who is President Uhuru Kenyatta, his lawyers Fred Ngatia and Ahmed Nasir Abdullahi, making their submissions early in the morning, not really early, from 11 a.m. Into the afternoon. Later yesterday, of course, there was that report from the scrutiny of the Forms 34A, which was going on at the Milimani Law Court, and at the IBC headquarters, where a scrutiny of the IEB servers was going on, and a report on those two processes was presented later in the evening before the judges, with different parties also making submissions on the same. And all that information now is with the judges, and we do expect that that ruling will be presented on Friday. The other headline that's on the Standard: fireworks over servers, verdict left to seven judges. And of course, after heated exchanges with Viola team, claiming there was deception, hacking and forgery, and Uhuru team was claiming that there was no basis for annulling his win, hearing has ended, verdict now in the hands of the judges. Of course, this has been the main talking point since last week, but now, between now and Friday, there's nothing much to talk about. Of course, quite a number of headlines on the inside pages. Still, the presidential election petition getting quite a lot of pages on the dailies. On the Daily Nation, of course, the front page, page 2, 3, 4, 5. The first five pages have been dedicated to the Supreme Court presidential election petition between the, currently before the Supreme Court. On the Standard, page 1, that's the front page, page 4, 5, 6, 7, yes, an equal number of pages, about 4 or 5 pages dedicated to the Supreme Court. This morning we're privileged to have Zach Kinodia as for the news review. Zach Kinodia is a political analyst. Good morning, Zach. Karibu sana. It's been a while. I think the last time you were on this panel was before the elections. Quite a lot has happened after that. I saw a joke somewhere that August, the month of August, seemed to have been elongated somewhat, because quite a lot has happened. Remember, the pre-election tension, then the elections came, then after that the election results came, then after that we saw the dispute, then after that governors were sworn in, NASA moved to court to challenge the presidential election. Now members of parliament elect are going into the house, they're going through orientation. Quite a lot is happening, and it appears like it's been like 6 months or so. The month of August is still not ending. Today is actually 30th. We still have one more day before August ends. What do you think, Zach?
Thank you, and good morning to you, Fred. I remember, I think January, the country had experienced such a hot weather, and Kenyans online, with their usual jibes of jokes, went ahead to say that it seems in Nairobi the sun is between Nairobi and the earth, instead of the earth being between Nairobi and the sun. So the month was long, and there are good reasons why it was long. It was a month that was anticipated, and a month which has been hyped for the last 4 years, and now it came, and the major business was done, and after major business, the proceedings following the major business were to follow. But most importantly is that it has gone the way it should have gone, and we thank Kenyans, because looking at all that we have been preparing, remember, for the sake of this month, the government used 50 billion shillings to conduct elections across the country, grassroots elections to MCAs all the way up to the president. And remember, 50 billion shillings in 1 month is not a joke. It's actually 1 day, and then the few billions or millions of money that will go into the presidential petition that was launched by NASA through their leader, Honorable Right Prime Minister Raila Odinga. And Therefore, the month was longer for Kenyans. I think it's ending tomorrow.
Yes, the month is ending tomorrow. And I think that's why we're talking about it, because it appears like it was never ending.
Yes.
Of course, we still have to await that ruling by the Supreme Court come Friday. But I can see even Eunice Lumalas, an advocate of the High Court, is joining the panel in a short while. We'll be looking at some of the intrigues from the Supreme Court proceedings in a short while. But back to these other headlines.
Yes.
Of course, the other very interesting thing that's happening before the month comes to an end is the orientation of members of the National Assembly and the Senate. Newly elected members right now are just going through orientation. Yesterday they were there. And if we could watch that story by Stephen Leto, which has a lot of prospects with regard to the election of the Speaker of the National Assembly as well as the Senate. The story by Leto.
Senate head for an internal poll to elect their respective speakers. And today, campaigns for the job were at a crescendo, with outgoing Speaker of the National Assembly meeting newly elected MPs to sell his bid.
You know, now is the time for us to campaign. Yes, because I'm told by the clerk that those of us that have picked the forms and have complied with all the requirements have now submitted.
The speaker we have already settled. We are supporting Muturi as our speaker. As you know, Jubilee family is a family of unity.
National Assembly Clerk Michael Sialai and his Senate counterpart Jeremiah Nyegenye separately making public names of applicants cleared to run. In the National Assembly, incumbent Speaker Justin Muturi is poised to retain his seat but will battle it out with Noah Winja and Washington Onyango. Moses Ole Sakuda withdrew his candidature with reports that Jubilee top brass had to intervene to secure Muturi an easy ride. Kurasoi North MP-elect Moses Cheboi was the only one in the Deputy Speaker's race after Samburu West MP-elect Naisula Lesuda and Gilgil's Martha Wangari failed to return their papers. In the Senate, Ekwe Thuro will fight to retain his seat, with former Bungoma Governor Ken Lusaka viewed to be Jubilee Party's favorite. NASA is fielding former Lagdera MP Farah Maalim. Others in the race are Dr. James Gesami, former Migori Senator Wilfred Machage. Nairobi Senator-elect Johnson Sakaja has since withdrew his candidature for Deputy Speaker of the Senate, with Nakuru Senator-elect Susan Kihika poised to the Deputy Speaker's post. Earlier MPs were today taken through induction in preparation for the swearing-in on Thursday.
My first day feeling in Parliament is very exciting, and it's like first day in the university or first day in the school or first day in the employment. We are really looking forward to Thursday so that we can be sworn in, so that we can hit the road running.
They took us through the history of Parliament from the first speaker, Osa Mzungu, to where we are now, which I think is very important to new members of the House.
Tomorrow, senators will have their induction from 9 a.m. Stephen Leto, Citizen TV, Nairobi.
Yes, so Stephen Leto rightly puts it, senators are going in for induction today. Yesterday was a part of the National Assembly, and as one of those members there rightly put it, it felt like the first day of Form 1 or first day at the university. And it must be very exciting, Zach, for a newly elected member. I've read somewhere in one of the dailies, and because this story is also on pages 6 of the Daily Nation and page 10 of the Standard this morning, and the excitement was clear among members, newly elected MPs, including the 23-year-old who was elected in Meru, and he says he actually took a matatu from Meru, then walked all the way from, they call it tea room, all the way up to Parliament buildings, and no one could recognize him.
did he find his way?
he found his way. At least he did find his way. That was very interesting. I think that story is on page 10 of the of the Standard. He's called Paul Mwirigi, the MP for Igembe South, a 23-year-old MP for Igembe South, fresh from the university. For him, I'm sure the feeling is just as it was in the university, but some of these older members, some of them have been there. People like Maoka Maore, Igembe North, He was there 10 years ago. That was in the 9th parliament.
Yes, 9th.
He missed out in the 10th and 11th. Now he's back. And even him, he was excited just to be back.
Yeah. There are good reasons why, Fred, because first of all, the veil of ignorance for the youngest member of parliament is about to fall, and it is going to be ruthlessly be removed by the etiquette of the office of the member of parliament, because parliament, truth be said, parliament is a house of honor. It is a house of it is a natural, it is a caste kind, where out of 45 million Kenyans, only 290 are elected. That's a very insignificant percentage, and if you find yourself among the number, then you are rarely a privilege for many people. So these younger men, for instance, who has gone to parliament with the old guards like Maoka Maore, who had been in parliament for such a long time, are bound to experience excitement in different manner. One is excited because of vintageness of parliament. Another one is excited because of the newness, if you could call it. They have never been there, but they are going to be oriented differently. Remember, others have never known what is parliament. I was actually telling a friend yesterday, standing orders and hansards and the behaviors of parliament, 70% of MPs today do not understand what it is. That's why it was important for them to be taken through induction, because they have not been, they have not had, they have not experienced. For them, being an MP is rushing with a big car in the village and distributing forms of
because that will change. That will definitely change. Yeah. Even Paul Murigi, the 23-year-old MP from Igembe South, will have to start moving in those big cars. Yesterday he walked from tea room to the National Assembly.
You should have sent your driver to pick
after tomorrow. Things will definitely change.
Maybe you should have sent your driver to at least pay him some cattle in the city.
I don't have a driver. I don't have a driver. But one of those pictures there on page 10 of the Standard, where newly elected members are being taken through orientation, and the picture there shows them being shown by one of the parliamentary orderlies the bar at the door to the chamber, during which whenever MPs are voting in the house, the bar remains shut and prevents any member from accessing the chamber. So they were being taken round and round. We do understand that Vincent Kimosop has also walked into the studio, will be joining the panel shortly. But let me introduce Eunice Lumalas, advocate of the High Court. Eunice, good morning and karibu sana.
Good morning, thank
I'm
you.
Sure most of your week has been spent watching the proceedings at the Supreme Court, understandably so.
Absolutely.
Because you are a legal mind. So for a moment, let's go back towards what was happening yesterday. And quite a lot has changed, quite a lot has happened. Now, what should we expect going forward? Probably that's the best question to ask, because now we do understand all the submissions have been made. The reports that the judges had asked for, the report was presented yesterday. They sat late into the night. Now we do understand they're going on a retreat. Are they going to be somewhere that we know? What happens during this time before they deliver their ruling on Friday?
What we expect right now is that, and by the way, just permit me to say that how the Supreme Court, this particular second Supreme Court under the new constitution, incidentally we are celebrating the first anniversary of our 2010 constitution.
Yes.
So we expect them to retire. They've done a great job in terms of time management, and counsel as well appearing before the Supreme Court have done a fantastic job. So we expect them to retire now. We hope that Justice Ibrahim will get well enough to join the rest. But we expect that they will retire. If they are going to a quiet, nice place to retire, even better.
So when you say they are going to retire, what do we expect this retirement to be?
Retirement simply means they will now move from the court scene and go back to like retreat to a place where they can now focus on working on the judgment that is expected to be delivered either on second or any time before the first or the second of
That's Friday. That's the very last day they get to deliver that ruling.
Yes.
But on this issue of them going on a retreat, are they going somewhere where it's public? Will we, for example, know that they are at this particular hotel, or we know that they are going to just be within the Supreme Court? What do we expect?
I think in terms of expectations, whether they are within the Supreme Court or they decide to go somewhere where they can be alone and quiet, it's possible. It's not easy to contain people from either informing people, you know, we have the Supreme Court judges here at Manzoni or somewhere. It's perfectly in order for them to either decide to work within the Supreme Court, which is possible, or to retire, to go somewhere else, to retreat somewhere else outside the presence of the Supreme Court.
So it's not necessarily that they have to be at a secret location?
No, it is not.
Okay.
But in terms of the documentation and everything, uh-huh. and the security of all the litany of documents and, you know, filed, it's expected that they might actually decide to work within the Supreme Court, where if it allows. It's still in order.
Uh-huh.
Yes.
Okay, now, Eunice, because we were expecting you yesterday on the panel and I had one very important question for you. It's the lack of, or maybe not lack, but the few numbers of female lawyers that we saw, the very few number of female lawyers that we saw addressing the Supreme Court yesterday. You're one of those advocates who's been seen, and now you're a familiar face on TV. How come we did not see, like what we saw back in 2013, Akethi Kilonzo coming out and making a name for herself? This time round, even the female lawyers that we saw were really behind the scenes, not really the lead counsel in any of these arguments.
Dimuli, you know my position on that. It is something that disturbed me, something that it actually looks, it doesn't look good to me. And I believe there is need to do an analysis of women in the legal profession. We only saw one lady submitting. There is Madam Lucy mm-hmm. Kambuni. And in my view, it's something that needs to be deliberate, you know. Those who are appointing counsel, they need to give an opportunity to other, particularly women lawyers.
Mm-hmm.
There are women lawyers who are capable. You know, I'm not looking for a job for myself. However,
but also Eunice, and this is one of the questions, because we saw some other lawyers, including lawyer Kanjama, trying to apply to be enjoined in the case as amicus curiae, but we did not see any female advocates doing the same. Surely, even an attempt to try and be part of the case, even if you're not working with the major parties, at least that would have been seen as an attempt.
I don't believe so, because in this specific petition we had definite parties, okay? We had the petitioners. So the petitioners had a duty to probably incorporate female lawyers in their panels, mm-hmm. okay, and give them an opportunity to address the court, which they failed to do. And then we had the respondents. We had IBC. IBC had an all-male panel. We had Mr. Chebukati, who had male panel as well, and we had the third respondent, who is the president of the republic, the president elect,
mm-hmm.
Pardon me, of the Republic of Kenya, who had also an all male counsel. There's very limited opportunity for amicus, as you rightfully so. I know Kanjama, we had discussed, he had expected to be, and I think he's a very objective and a good advocate, and he had expected to go there and give an objective view, you know, to the court as an interested party. But you know, LSK, he's a member of the Law Society of Kenya as well, which had applied to be an amicus as well, albeit with the kind of challenges it had in mm-hmm. terms of an affidavit being filed and saying that the council is divided. However, yes, Law Society, having been admitted as an interested party, there would be no virtue in women or female advocates applying for that reason. So what Law Society of Kenya should have done is to give an opportunity to female lawyers, which I'm very disappointed to say the Law Society Council failed to do as well.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a very annoying state of affairs, if you ask me.
Yes.
Yes. Because it's very deliberate. So you have to look at the
I think I belong to a different school of thought on this. Mm-hmm. And of course, maybe let me say by saying good morning all first.
Good morning and welcome.
Thank
this
you.
Panel.
Yeah, I think I agree that it is important to. It's very, very important for us to be inclusive in all our approaches. These are our sisters, these are our daughters. And it was a good story to tell about Kathy Kilonzo and how she performed in 2013. But also, I think it is, as an economist, I will always say that the market dictates If you go to the dictates of the market, the demand and the supply of what was required is a good representation and a good win. So as a client, in this situation, you as a rational consumer, you go for what you are sure about, that you're going to get victory or get somebody who's going to argue your case. So I think I think we have also to balance the.
Are you suggesting that we do not have a lawyer who can actually?
I haven't said that. I think the advantage of
the party is they were just going for who they thought would better present.
I'm talking about the dictates. You see, they remember that. As a rational consumer, you when you go to the market, when you're going to buy fruits, you don't necessarily buy because so and so is of this gender. You go for what you want. So I think we also need to balance the that conversation. I would have expected maybe an interested party like LSK. It's easy to have that conversation, and even maybe the Attorney General, who were invited as amicus, to be able to speak to that concern. But pushing it to the petitioner and to the first and the second respondent, I think at times we need to appreciate also the other dynamics that come into play, and that greater conversation would be taken to maybe LSK, which is really the body responsible for regulating the legal profession, on how this issue of two-thirds gender principle is going
and
to be enhanced.
How about the fact that none of these female advocates even tried to apply to be joined?
You see, those are the questions that, that's what I'm saying. For me, I would look at, I would take that conversation to LSK, and not necessarily put it on the part of the client, because these are consumers of a product.
Okay.
And Demoli, I may just interject. First of all, advocates do not apply to join a case. Counsel get instructed, okay? So you have to look at the instructing bodies. My brother there, I forgot his name,
Kimosop,
sorry. He talks about you go for what you want. I would like him to read this book, The Outliers, because sometimes you are a product of the opportunities that you get. So it's up to the Attorney General maybe to step aside and decide, I would like one of my council, state councils, to submit, or LSK in its three-member panel to appoint one lady. It's all about the appointing authority. So lawyers get instructed. You do not, you do not act until you're instructed. That's how it works. And so it goes to the instructing bodies. When you look at most institutions, you cannot say that someone like Ethic Kilonzo would have been sort of more or less discovered without having been given an opportunity. So I think we need to open up that space. If there are cartels that are all male dominated, we need to break those cartels and allow women and give them opportunities as counsel.
Yes. Cartels within the legal fraternity in Kenya.
Do not quote me.
I'm an advocate of the high court.
No, but you appreciate, Fred, that at the end of the day, I'm purely speaking here as a rational consumer. You will definitely go for that which you know is going to you, as in what your resources and what your interested outcome is going to be. So I think the best way of moving the conversation forward is challenging platforms that would therefore avail. It would be great to have been seen our colleague doing a good job, as in that is something we all desire. But I think it is good for us to pick lessons from this and take those conversations to places where those things can be furthered. But really, by maybe putting the petition and first and the first second respondent on the defense, I think for me, I would be hesitant to go into that.
But Kimosop, there were quite a number of parties involved in this trial. Maybe not necessarily the petitioner or the main respondents, but there were also various other. Parties involved, including some of the presidential candidates who are not necessarily petitioners. And we're just saying that opportunities were there to actually have more women appear and address the court, because the only one woman did that, and for only 15 minutes.
Two of them.
Yes.
two. We had Lucy Kamboni,
uh-huh.
and also we had Njana. I think the
for a total of how long? People have been talking for more than 15 hours.
and that's how I think. I think in principle, Fred, we are all agreed. It is important to involve, you know, inclusivity. Let the society be reflected, because this is the highest court that any lawyer desires to be either a judge in that court,
just or an opportunity to
or even address
the Supreme Court.
Yes. But also at the same time, that's what I was pointing out, that how do we move the conversation forward to frontiers that would deliver results, so that we also don't have this approach of complaining, or this didn't happen. Because a decision has to be rendered.
Vincent, we're not complaining. We're just saying that the talk about gender parity is one that is very key right now at this point in time. One of the headlines you're looking at, the county assemblies have had to pick 560 members just to fill the gender gap.
Yes.
In the National Assembly, this talk of two-thirds gender parity will have to come up sometime next week after they're sworn in. And if they do not do that, if they do not sort out the problem, they're just risking quite probably litigation in court. People are actually challenging the legality or the constitutionality of the National Assembly and the Senate as currently constituted.
Mm.
So the issue of gender is very key, and it's one that will continue.
Fully agreed, Francis. And
it was just interesting to see that courtroom packed with men, and you could point out only 1, 2, 3, 4 female lawyers there.
And that's what I was saying, Fred. We need to have this let's have this conversation in a whole. Let's look at it in a holistic approach. I agree. Parliament needs to meet the two-thirds gender principle, and as currently constituted, they haven't met the threshold. And I think they need to pass the legislation as instructed by court. And that's what I'm saying, Fred. Let's have this. It has to be an incremental, and let's take this conversation to where things will move ahead. I have already pointed out that I think this LSK needs to have this conversation among itself, because it is the body responsible for regulating the profession, so that we leave the letter and the spirit of the constitution.
Mm-hmm. Zach, I'm sure you must have something to say about this, in as far as gender parity is concerned, in as far as female representation even in that courtroom.
Now, this was a unique year of events that led to Supreme Court battles in the legal field. First of all, we saw women did not make it among the 8 presidential candidates who were submitting their candidature for president. Unlike other years.
Yes.
Legal fraternity of Kenya is not lacking in terms of women resources. Let's agree, Kenya has trained a good number of women as lawyers as it has for men. So this is not where we say that we need gender boost to have lawyers, or to have advocates, or to have judges.
Because I understand the difference between the number of Kenyan advocates who are male and females is very minimal.
Yeah.
There are more than 6,000 female advocates about 8,000 male advocates.
That's about 52%.
Yes.
48% women and 52. But the truth is, and I will not go legal like my sister, neither shall I go economic like he has said, about economic demands of economies. I will go political and say, if I was a woman practicing as an advocate in this country, I would not touch the case at Supreme Court.
Why?
I would keep my peace, because it is the highest flying case, which is likely,
Zach, the opportunity
to expose you.
The opportunity to address the highest court in the land does not present itself quite often. The next time you're going to see that Supreme Court seat will be maybe in another 1-2 years if a different matter comes before it.
If
not, maybe until 2022, if at all the presidential election petition then is challenged.
True, I agree with you. It's a rare opportunity which presents privileges, but there are some privileges that you watch and let them go in life, because
are you trying to ask women to stay away from such an
absolutely
opportunity?
Let me be clear. If I was talking about my wife or my daughter as a lawyer, I would tell her not to go to Supreme Court in a high-flying political case.
Let's listen to you. Yes, why would you?
Because this is a political case more as it is of legal. And remember Kathy Kilonzo, when she first appeared in the panel, all her private life was put into public, and she was actually faulted for having been a lawyer who is not politically conscious, because it was accused, she was accused of not having even voted for her father.
Mm-hmm.
And then she wanted to be a lawyer, he wanted to be a senator, things of that sort.
Mm-hmm.
So if mm-hmm. then she's given another chance, and I know this is probably why she never came to BZ as a same case NASA, because her life was put into exposure. These things, as you know, are more political, and you're not going to look at women in Supreme Court as Kenyans from the light of legal qualifications they have got, because they are qualified equally as men.
Yeah.
But they're going to be attacked on other things, especially if they present a very competent case for their party that they are representing. That's why they keep it off.
But don't you think just by discouraging them on that note, even you'd be telling them not to take part even in political contests,
mm-hmm.
Because they would run the same risk of their lives or their personal lives being exposed. Vincent?
I think we need to be, I would really heavily and respectfully disagree with the comments that my brother has made, that I would we should not allow females to participate in such petitions because they are political. I think our society talks about inclusivity, and we need to challenge the things that are keeping women away from such platforms.
Yeah.
And just because we've had a patriarchal society that has disadvantaged women, including exposure, those are the very things and the barriers that needs to be confronted. Saying that they should not be involved because they will be exposed. Who is exposing them? How come their male counterparts are not exposed? I think my brother, I would say that let us participate in actually challenging those cultures and those things that are actually putting women down, because they are part and parcel of society.
Okay.
That for me, I think, even though however political it is, we have a responsibility to participate in bringing those barriers down.
I want us to move forward and talk about another headline. But before that, because we have Eunice Lumala, and she's an advocate, I would just need clarification on the composition of the Supreme Court. It's among the headlines. One of the judges, midway the hearings, was taken ill, Judge Justice Mohamed Ibrahim. Now we have 6 judges of the Supreme Court. How does that affect this matter, given that we're only 2 days or at least before the ruling is made? And as far as the composition of the court is concerned, there have been questions on the fact that if at all he's not able to return to the bench for this matter, now we have 6 judges. That means there could be a tie in the vote. That's a possibility, because now it's an even number. What happens? Once he gets better, does he just automatically resume his position in the bench on this matter, or because he was taken ill midway and he did not get to hear a lot of the arguments presented before court yesterday, does he now stay away completely?
Well, I expect that Honorable Justice Ibrahim will get better and then resume his work, whether or not he was there yesterday, because as you rightfully say, having missed only one day, I think he missed a lot that happened. Nonetheless, I think who knows what he did. Perhaps he was watching the proceedings. We hope that he's not that badly off. But should he not be able to resume, the next possible odd number would be 5. So a verdict from any 5 of them would stand, because
but
it's the odd number.
How do you pick the 5?
The chair. I would think the logical thing to do is to have the chair allow the rest of the 5 to proceed.
Yes. In 2013, this discussion happened. You remember that the justice, Nancy Baraza, was out of was not sitting at that time, and this conversation happened as to whether the 6 judges of the Supreme Court can sit, and the answer that came out was an emphatic yes, that the 6 judges can sit. The Constitution requires that we have a minimum of 5 for them to render a decision. Now, this is what is going to happen, Fred, in the event, and really we pray that may the Lord touch and grant good health Justice Ibrahim, that he can be able to sit and that we can have an odd number, 7. But in the event he does not sit, it is still okay for the 6 judges to be able to sit. And to answer your question, Fred, that what happens if you have a tie? If there is a tie between the 6 judges, then status quo remains, meaning that Uhuru Kenyatta's win is going to be upheld.
So if at all they sit and vote and it goes
50-50? 3-3? Yes. Status quo.
Status quo.
Yeah, that means the decision that was the declaration of Uhuru Kenyatta as president-elect is going to be upheld, yes.
Okay, those are very interesting. We're in for very interesting times. We just wait to see what will happen by Friday. But do you think that it would be right for a judge to take a break for any reason and then return on this matter and still get to decide at the very end? If in the case of Justice Mohamed Ibrahim, he was taken ill midway. He did not get to hear some of the submissions inside court. As Advocate Lumala says, maybe he was watching on TV. But if now he gets better today or tomorrow, do we expect him just to come back and join the bench and be part of the ruling?
I think it is, because remember the participants or the petitioner and the respondents, they make oral submissions, but they also make written submissions. Mm-hmm. So some of the evidence is before them, and remember the judgment will be rendered on different issues, the consolidation of the issues. So perhaps the Justice Ibrahim would also make submissions on things that he has sat and participated in as part of enriching the judgment. That's my view of the same. Mm-hmm. because it will be great to have a seven panel judgment so that we can get to hear what was their view on these issues, if it was unanimous, if there was a difference. That is part of the growth and the institutionalization process of this critical institution that is the Supreme Court.
Zach, anything to add on that before we move to Parliament and the election of the National Assembly Speaker?
Yes, I would say that, first of all, as per the question you had asked earlier when we started, it is very important and critical that the retreat of these judges be conducive and away from Supreme Court in an undisclosed position to the public. that's the best way.
But it's not a requirement.
It's not a law requirement. It's just common sense and the right thing to do, because they need peace of mind to write the judgment. And Justice Ibrahim would be extremely important to be available if and when God grants him health back, because his judgment, as per what has been submitted by both parties and the other parties that enjoined the suit, is that he stands a chance to understand things differently from the other six, and his judgment is important to be included in what we call now the judgment book, which will be read to Kenyans on or before Friday.
Yes.
Because six, as he said, status quo can be upheld because of the vote of the incumbency. But that be the case as it may, we want a decisive judgment as was done in 2013, when the six judges unanimously agreed that the election was credible, free and fair, and that they upheld the judgment or rather the declaration of IEBC. So it is important that he be available, and we hope that he will be available, because his health was not as bad
away from even the main ruling, which could be unanimous, could be from a vote. Every pronouncement by any of the judges during this time will make for judicial precedence going forward, and people will be referring to the case because it will be on record. Let's move on now to other issues, and the National Assembly and the Senate will hold their very first sittings tomorrow, where members-elect will be sworn into office, giving life to the 12th Parliament. In as far as the election of Speaker is concerned, if you look at page 19 of the Daily Nation, there are two, three advertisements from the 12th Parliament. One has to do with the nominated candidates for election of Speaker of the National Assembly. Initially, there was a list of 23. Yes? From the 23, they were required. Those are the people who submitted the applications for the job. They were required to submit papers together with their CVs and present them by Tuesday 29th of August, which was yesterday. Only six managed to do that. This is as far as the Speaker of the National Assembly is concerned. We had Augo Jim Boniface, Muturi Justin, Ngao Gladys Kasiva, Onyango Washington Andago, Wainaina Isaac Wangengi, and Winja Noah Migudo. Now, from those six, and this is according to this ad, pursuant to the provisions of Article 106 of the Constitution and Standing Order 5 of the National Assembly, of the persons who completed and submitted their nomination papers, the following persons qualify as candidates for election as Speaker of the National Assembly. They are three. We have Migudo, Dr. Noah Winja, Muturi Honorable Justin Bidan Joka, and Onyango Washington Andango. Now, this is as good as done, Vincent. Do you think anything will change? It looks like the script will remain the same.
I will not even repeat what you've just said. I've just said, you know, the way you say that, I agree with it. The seat of the speaker is a very important seat, because if you look at the constitution, the Speaker of the National Assembly is the third in line in the event, in the unfortunate event you don't have a president and a deputy president. It is the Speaker of the National Assembly who is going to be sworn in for, I think, 60 days. Number two is also the political nature of that seat. You remember, most of the decisions are rendered by the National Assembly, or more legislation are done by the National Assembly. So you would want somebody you have confidence and you believe will be able to facilitate your decisions. Politically, now I'm speaking as my, my friend would have pointed out. So any sitting president or any anyone in power would want to have a speaker who actually, yes, is objective, but advances the your political agenda. So in my view, I think you don't need to be a skyrocket scientist to see the political communication clearly,
yes,
that it is going to be Muturi, JB Muturi. So and just look at even the profile of the other. You remember the only contestant so far is the one of the Senate. So meaning that the political message has not been very clear on whom we are going. But by yesterday, when you see people like Sakaja stepping aside because of Ken Lusaka, it tells you...
But that was for the position Senate. Of deputy speaker of the Senate. Sakaja as an elected member...
The message was
going for deputy speaker,
but they say that he is from the information I got, he's is opting out for the purposes of, you know, regional balancing. That,
yes.
So that I can support Ken Lusaka. So,
and as far as the Senate is concerned, of course, Ekwe Furo, that's the Speaker of the Senate.
Yes.
Ken Lusaka, the former governor for Bungoma, and Farama Alim, who ran for Garissa Town MP but was not successful as the candidates for Speaker of the Senate. Of course, Jubilee is backing Ken Lusaka. We still they do have a majority in both the Senate and the National Assembly. Back to the National Assembly, Eunice Lumalas, of course, some people were saying that probably because President Uhuru Kenyatta is seeking this time round not to run for office again, but probably to consolidate and to pursue his legacy, so that by the time he leaves office, at least there's he leaves a legacy, that probably he would seek a change in the National Assembly. But now we're seeing that it looks likely to remain the same, with Justin Muturi continuing as speaker.
Okay, but interesting what I'm reading from what you're asking, seeking to leave a legacy, seeking possibly to change from Justin, Honorable Justin Muturi. I don't know. But basically, having said that, I do not think there'll be a change. I actually believe there'll be no change. I think we expect that Honorable Justin Muturi will continue as Speaker of the National Assembly.
What about the Senate?
Yeah. For Senate, I think let's expect anything, because the games that have been played in campaigns, once you get to the House and you've been sworn in, it's a different ballgame. Okay, so we'll expect cross alliances. You know, it will not be just NASA and Jubilee and the rest. Okay, we'll expect to see, for example, don't be surprised when you see Farah Maalim has become Speaker of the Senate.
Wow.
Because you expect that the you know, the numbers are almost the same.
Nice.
But don't be surprised when you see that people from his region in Jubilee side are voting for him.
Yes.
So let's expect anything, actually.
And of course, our time is up, but I have to ask Zaki Nuthia to give his opinion on this matter. In as far as the National Assembly is concerned, it looks as good as done. The Speaker of the National Assembly, we just wait for that formality tomorrow. But when it comes to the Senate, Ken Lusaka, of course, he has been the Jubilee Alliance Party chairman, and the Jubilee Party would be seeking to at least reward him with something. Do you see him as a likely winner in this contest?
This is what I foresee. Now that Lusaka and the incumbent Speaker of the Senate, if they happen, and this is if they happen to be on the ballot on the voting day, agree with the advocate, mm-hmm. Jubilee may lose it. Because the two are as good as Jubilee lieutenants, both and strong enough, each. Mm-hmm. And the vote is going to be divided.
So it could just give room for Farah Mahali.
They can lose it. They can lose it. That is Senate.
Yes,
they can lose it on that ground. If they happen both to go together.
Mm-hmm.
But on the National Assembly, as you say, it's as good as cast. But there's something that I read this morning coming through Citizen TV, which was very shocking. Another TVs, that the candidate for Deputy Speaker in the National Assembly, Honorable Martha Wangari and Naisuda, have withdrawn.
Yes, mm-hmm. With every,
and that's very wrong. Because if it is as good as done that Muturi is going to be the Speaker, then it only leaves a male candidate to be his deputy.
Yes, Moses Cheboi looks set to be the Deputy
yes.
Speaker. He's the only candidate who qualified and is the only name
yeah.
on that list of nominees. But unfortunately, our time is up. Zach, I have
which is bad for
there.
Ladies, eh?
Yes.
Women should have been there.
Back to that discussion. Gender parity is still a problem.
Yeah. Friend, I wanted to say something, eh? That on the issue of Ekwe Ethuro in the Senate.
Yes, Vincent, where? Unfortunately, my director is rushing me out of the studio.
There's another side
there. Thank you so much, Vincent Kimosopa, Zaki Nothia, and Eunice Lumalas for helping us look at the headlines this morning. We need to give room for Cheche, a show where opinion counts. My name is Fred Ndibuli. Good morning.
Good morning.